Okay, thank you very much for inviting me. I'm very happy to be here today to talk about UAV communication. So I started my group at KU Leuven 6 years ago. I moved from IMEC to Leuven, and then I had to think what would be a good topic to work on. I had an expertise on wireless communication, and then drones was one of the research lines I started then. For various reasons, because I believed in it in the long term, and I also think it's a good way to attract very good students. And both my predictions have turned out to be right, I think. It allowed me to build up a very strong team with good researchers, and I also think that the drone communication is only starting to boom now, so it was like a good idea to do that 6 years ago. First, some words about KU Leuven or Leuven. So we are proud of several things. Leuven is a small city in Belgium. It has only about 100,000 people, but it's a very important student city. So we are very proud of Stella Artois. So Stella Artois is a beer with the headquarters in Leuven. And we are also very famous over university. So this is a main picture from the university, is the library. And we are also very proud of the fact that our university is sometimes ranked quite high. So, for instance, it's the most innovative university outside of the United States because we have lots of collaborations with industry. So one more thing I have to say. So KU Leuven is a Dutch one. It's almost 600 years old. There's also a French part of Leuven. 50 years ago, we kicked out the French-speaking professors and they founded a new Leuven about 20 kilometers away. So what happened with the library? There were lots of books in the library, so the first book stayed in Leuven, the second went to the French, the third stayed in Leuven, the fourth went to the French. So we split everything quite fairly. I know there's a lot of confusion that there are two Leuvens, but I believe I'm from the real one because I'm from the old one that was there first, right? Something more about Leuven, so we like historical buildings. So the Faculty of Engineering is headquartered in this nice castle in a nice green environment, because Leuven is a small city, we don't have a lot of buildings, it's very green. So the Faculty of Engineering was founded 160 years ago, so it's quite old faculty. And it is quite big, it has about 120 professors and more than 3,000 students for engineering. In Leuven we have all disciplines, eh? Engineering has 3,000 students. I'm from the Electrical Engineering Department, which has a building that looks like that. And what to know from this department is that we spin off IMEC Research Center 30 years ago. It has now outgrown the Faculty of the Engineering Department. It has even outgrown the Faculty of Engineering, which you can see here. IMEC is clearly visible on our landmark picture. And it has outgrown the faculty. So IMEC now has about 3,000 full-time researchers employed. So this is a bit of a history. So this is my team. We like to take pictures from ourselves in front of our landmarks, both IMEC and the Faculty of Engineering. So I have a nice team, and I'm very proud of the fact that it's very international. I do that to encourage diversity, and it works very well because everybody works together. Everybody has to work together because you have to talk to each other and respect each other's culture. And we call ourselves Network System Group. So I see that this is a good event here because we do a lot about network systems. So what do we do? We do a lot of theoretical work, performance analysis, but I also like to do a lot of hands-on practical implementation, and we really try to be ahead of all the rest. So we want to do innovative systems, first in the world kind of things. So this is an old system that we built. It's a full duplex network, so we have many of them. So we have the physical layer, the MAC layer, we have a network running with full duplex. So this is National Instruments Software Defined Radio, and we took a chip from IMEC, because IMEC is so close, we take their chips, we do the system integration for them, and we can build innovative system. Also for millimeter wave, this is a phase array converter designed by TU Dresden, the group of Gerard Vetwijs. It has 16 input ports, which is really cool. Every input port is one angle of the phase array, and we can connect it to our massive MIMO testbed that we also already had in the lab. So we try to build really innovative systems and work with very good research group to have the hardware to build that. Of course, we also do a lot of drone stuff. We have this EWOL distributed antenna system. This is already old. We have this already for 6 years. And also some simple stuff like IoT. That's not the goal of today. Today, I'm going to talk about drone swarm applications. I have to start with the application first, because you need to motivate why you're doing what you do. Drone communication, because that's our expertise. We are wireless communication experts, and then sense and avoid for drone. So why are we doing it? Because we believe the drone market is booming or will grow. Of course, there's a lot of defense applications, but also civilian applications will take up. And if you look into civilian applications, infrastructure monitoring, agriculture, security, media and entertainment, and also for telecom. So these are the main domains where drones might have a meaningful, impactful role. Of course, we're electrical engineers, we're not mechanical engineers or robotic experts. We don't make the drones, we focus on the drone payloads. So the thing you hang under the drone, not on top, but under the drone. And so if you look at a payload market, then you see the market will be in cameras, sensors, radars, and also communication equipment, which is where we focus on. Okay, then several years ago when we started to write our project, we thought, what are now the main challenges that we have to solve? The main UAV bottlenecks, we believe, are number one, safety and reliability. So we're never going to have this booming market if we don't have safe and reliable drones. This is number one. Second, we believe ease of use. I don't know who of you has ever flown or used a drone. Well, maybe I'm a very incompetent pilot, but I hit stuff, you know. So it's not so easy to operate a drone. And the third problem is the lifetime of the UAV. So especially these quadrotor kind of drones, they cannot go for very long missions, right? So these are the things we have to solve. And why is safety an important thing? In the United States, already 8,000 people were injured in 2016, right? You know that? Of course, it's not true. It's fake news, but yeah. I thought it would be cool too. Okay, so we said, okay, our research will focus on that, and we will make a 720-degree camera payload with reliable wireless communication, onboard processing, and central learning and control for ease of use. So this is what we will do, right? Why 720-degree camera? It's a 360. It sees everywhere. And by having 720, you also have depth information. So it's stereo omnidirectional, which is very important for a drone, because a drone, it could be flying under a bridge, then you have to see on top of you to avoid going up, right? So we believe that by having this depth-aware omnidirectional view, we can make the drone more autonomous and reliable. Of course, you need reliable wireless communication, but we also believe you need onboard processing, because in case the reliable link drops anyway, we still need intelligence on the drone. And also, we want on-the-drone intelligence to make it easier to use. So if you want to do mission, high-level mission navigation, but the local stability control should happen on the drone. Okay, so this was the view we wrote. 2016, we said a drone is still looking something like that. It's quite heavy, it has a heavy payload, and you need multiple operators. One to operate the drone, one to operate the camera that's hanging under the drone to do the good framing. Imagine if you do some capturing of a reproduction of some event. So we need multiple operators for one drone, and we want to go to a situation where we have one operator remotely controlling a swarm of drones. And a swarm in our case is not thousands, but several. Not more than one, but not a thousand yet. And to do this, we need this real-time depth-aware 360, reliable 5G, and autonomy by vision, as I explained already before. So this is a bit how the camera looks like. So the 720-degree vision, this one doesn't have 720-degree, you need two. Because these cameras are a bit wide, and if you put this and this, then they overlap and you have 720-degree. So it's small, it can hang on a small drone. It is onboard processing to be power efficient, increases autonomy, and reducing latency and link dependency. For communication, we work on I will explain all that later, so I'll go a bit faster here. What our drone also does, we thought that's very important to make it safe, it does onboard person detection. And it's not so easy to do it from all angles, because sometimes the person, yeah, you just look at the head. But we believe it's very important to have drones capable of detecting people, so that by all means they avoid people and don't hit the person. So that's also something our drone is doing. And then I'm going to show you a movie about this reliable autonomy by vision. So this is a collaboration with some colleagues from the department. I'm not a vision expert, but they do a lot of a lot of vision. And they do this deep learning based, vision based learning to navigate of a drone. The idea is that at some point, imagine you want to do is you want to inspect a windmill in the ocean. The idea is that you do it 100 times manually, and then the drone has 100 videos to learn from. It could do it autonomously. So here, what the drone is doing, we have a simulated world, and the drone is learning to see depth. And based on depth, it tries to navigate autonomously in the 3D scene. So here you see the scene, and here you see the depth map. And using the depth map, it navigates in the corridor. So then, this deep learning-based approach was also tested in a cafeteria environment. It's our cafeteria. And you see it work. It does not hit anything, but did you see it? 9 out of 10 successful flights. So even straight corridor, 9 out of 10 successful flights. This is state of the art. This is a top group, my colleague. Deep learning-based autonomous navigation, 9 out of, this means if you fly 10 times, at least one time your drone hits a wall. Eh? I would not claim that to be extremely reliable yet. But anyway, so people are working on that. I'm sure it will improve in the future, and so that the drone can really navigate autonomously in a corridor. So yeah, navigating a T-junction, even less than 9 out of 10 is only 4 out of 5 successful flights. So this is what they call reliable autonomy by vision. So who knows things that we can get rid of the operator and the wireless link? Not yet, eh? So we still need something else to control a drone. So for this project, this first part was about application, where we have our 720-degree depth camera and this reliable link. We were thinking also about main applications to work on and to work with Flemish industry to make products out of this. Eh? And this was the outcome of our survey based on both market value but also interest from Flemish industry. The first topic was traffic monitoring. Use these drones to fly over highways to see congestion and count the number of cars. The second was broadcasting, where the idea was that, for instance, in Belgium, cycling, Tour de France kind of stuff, so very popular. But to make a video or to capture this is quite expensive, because you need helicopters flying over the cyclists, etc. If you could do this by drones, it would be easier. Moreover, they believe if you have the 720-degree camera, you have one drone here, another drone there. They both film the same thing here. But because of the depth information, you can recompute the 3D video, and then you do some smooth interpolation between the multiple camera feeds. So you can get really a smooth experience, and it's like as if your drone is following the cyclist, or you can get from any viewpoint as you want, but in the end it's just multiple drones that capture the scene in 3D. So we got a lot of interest from broadcasting companies. Also, inspections of windmills are very important in Belgium for the green energy. We don't have water or mountains to pump water up, so we have to do it with wind. But these things need to be inspected, so that's another one. And then, of course, also surveillance and safety. Okay, so this was about our drone applications.
Is it an order of priority?
I'm sorry?
Has this been an order of priority for the Flemish industry?
These four, yeah.
Or is they all the same?
Yeah, I think we prioritize them based on complexity of the technology, not based on business or market value. So this one was our first to focus on because we think it's the easiest. And this is the last because this is the more difficult because you also have this interpolation of cameras. And I think, so this was the easiest. This was the second in terms of technical complexity because surveillance, in the end, you just need many drones that collaborate. You don't need to interpolate the video feeds. This was the third because we want to do this autonomously. So we need, and we want more than 9 out of 10 successful inspections. So if we want to do this autonomous with deep learning, it's even more challenging. And this is the most challenging. In terms of a market potential, I don't know what would be the ranking. So so these were a bit, this is just to explain what applications we're focusing on, which are not like the real swarm application, but just typical drone application. Okay, now I'm gonna talk a bit about drone communication because we did a lot of work there on drone performance modeling and measurement. I'm gonna show you the main results. And then I'm going to talk about a project that we have which deals with sense and avoid for drones. So first, if you want to build this reliable communication, the first thing you think about is use 4G or LTE, the cellular network. So we also did Wi-Fi and other technology analysis, but I'm going to focus only on LTE for today. So the first thing we do, of course, is theoretical performance analysis. And how we do that? We do this using stochastic geometry. So what does that mean? We just throw a bunch of base stations on the floor, on the earth. And then we also have some antenna tilt parameters. So these base stations are designed for terrestrial communication, or they're tilted down a bit. We put some antennas on the drone, and then we try to compute some performance metrics of the drone connectivity. So in this scenario, you have both uplink and downlink cases. So in the uplink, the base station communicates to a drone, and the drone gets interference, possibly from other base stations that communicate to their UEs, right? So then we have a lot of interference problem. In the downlink, we have the opposite problem. The drone communicates with the base station, but interferes with another uplink communication. So yesterday we saw some measurement results from Samira. She focused on the downlink and she showed that downlink communication is indeed very good for drones. Why? They have a very good line of sight coverage with the base station, so the base station can hear the drone very well. But she did not focus on the interference that uplink communication, it's uplink, but it's pointing towards the ground, but it's still uplink because it's from UE to base station. That uplink communication will create interference to lots of other cells. So it's a bit, but it's true, uplink drone communication works very well because the drone is at a very favorable position. So today, we also did analysis for the uplink, but I'm not going to focus on it today in sake of time. Today, I'm going to focus on the downlink, which is from the base station to the drone. And the drone is then interfered by all the other base stations in the neighborhood. And this is the more challenging scenario, because of interference. And if you want a reliable link, it's a downlink that matters, right? So for the line of sight, we need a path loss model. So how we typically do this? So we have probability of line of sight and a path loss exponent. That's how wireless people model everything. So path loss exponent means the further you were away from the base station, the lower you receive power. And the exponent says you how fast the power decreases. So if you have free space communication, the path loss exponent is 2. But if you have a lot of shadowing and blockage, your path loss exponent is higher, typically. If you're in a room with a lot of reflections, you can have even a path loss lower than 2 because reflected energy gets absorbed. So what we have an angle-dependent path loss component, which means if the drone is very close to the earth, we have a high path loss exponent, lots of shadowing stuff. And the higher you go, it becomes more and more free space. And also we have an angle-dependent line of sight probability. The higher we go, the higher the probability of line of sight. So it's kind of a realistic model. And then we have the small scale fading, which is Nakagami. It's somewhere, it's quite a realistic model for those of you who are wireless experts, in between Rayleigh and Rice. Okay, then we have metrics. So what is our metric, signal to noise interference ratio? Coverage probability is the probability that our signal to noise interference power is above a certain threshold. We have the capacity, which is just a function of our signal to noise interference ratio.
That formula is not valid for the Gaussian model, right?
I'm sorry?
That formula is Shannon's formula for the Gaussian, the Coase signal for Gaussian.
Yeah, yeah.
Everybody uses it, and I always ask the question. This is not the formula for the capacity for the channel you described.
Yeah, true. True.
I mean, it's essentially
yeah. So this is not the so this is just for the AWGN channel. I've simplified it in the slide. And I simplified it a bit too much in the slide. So in the paper, so this is AWGN channel model. But it's actually true. This is for AWGN channel capacity. For a faded channel, you need some more integrals.
If you go to 4G or 5G, why don't you do combined time division multiplexes and frequency division multiplexes? In other words, I can actually have a special frequency and special timing for the UAV alone.
Yes, yes.
I have
yes.
the capacity to do that. Why do I have to worry? And then you don't have to worry about interference or anything.
Yeah, but it's taken up in the stochastic and the PPP model, the lambda parameter. Yeah. So.
No, you give me the UAV or the drone.
Yeah. So
my own time and frequency, and I don't interfere with anybody else.
Yeah. So it's so the drone, if it talks to one base station, it gets its own time, frequency, resource slot, and the neighboring base station, if you have cell planning, does not use that same time, frequency slot, but another one might use it. So the further away. So this model is
okay, so the way we're going is this, okay? All wireless companies I know, including Ericsson, Qualcomm, Nokia, Bell Labs.
Intercell interference coordination, yes?
They're moving towards SDNNV for wireless. If I have software-defined networks, network function virtualization for wireless, I can give you any time of the day, by minute, the time and frequency you need. Okay? In a time-varying fashion, okay? So you tell me what you need, and I give it to you, and I keep it just for you. And I have enough bandwidth to do that. Why this doesn't solve the problem, and I have to worry about interference and packet keeping?
Yeah, I disagree to that, because I'll show you some measurements later. A drone goes up, it sees 20 cells fur. Yeah. So if you need to do this kind of scheduling and intercell interference coordination for such large areas, it becomes really impossible and spectrally inefficient.
Sorry, maybe we can postpone the discussion after the topic is
recorded. Yeah. So the model, so it's quite a realistic model. So we know about scheduling, and and I'll confirm it with measurements later. So and by playing with the parameter, I'll show you some later. So this is the cool thing about models. You can sweep parameters quite easily. And of course, real networks are not operating on the whole parameter range, but you can always select a set of parameters that represent all these things that you say quite realistically. And actually, to come back to your earlier question on the AWGN channel, there's an expected value here, so it is a correct expression. Just simplify it. Okay, so we have, so it is the correct thing. You need to take into account the PDF, but it's just a simplified notation. The area spectral efficiency is just averaging it out over area, because if you have a cell closer to the base station, you have a better or worse SNR. So I'm not going to go into all these expressions here. I'm just going to show you the results. So we played with UAV antenna beamid. So the UAV antenna could be, if a patch antenna is already very wide, so then it sees already 180 degrees almost, because a patch antenna cannot see behind it. And this is 100 degrees is a bit more narrow, so then you have some kind of gain. And here you see, as function of the altitude, 50, 100 or 150 meter. So what can you see is, if the UAV is flying relatively low, then a high angle is optimal, because if it's flying relatively low, then it has more probability of finding a base station in any of its directions. But the higher it goes, if it sees too wide, it sees also too much interference, and it should decrease its view of the world. So this is what comes out of the model. And then here we have suburban, urban, and dense urban scenarios. And based on the urban versus suburban, the probability of line of sight is different. If you're urban, you have a lower probability of line of sight because there are more buildings blocking your link. And then we show that if you have dense urban, the UAV can actually fly higher. If it's in a rural environment, the moment the UAV goes up, it starts to be interfered by very far away base stations. Too far away so that they cannot take care, they could theoretically take care of the scheduling. But today that's not yet done, I would say. So conclusion here is suburban, the UAV altitude should be as low as possible, urban altitudes 20, 30 meter or okay. And we will confirm that later by simulations and measurements.
Take care of the big rooms in urban?
I'm sorry?
Because in many urban environments you have high buildings, so then the problem is very complex.
You have what? You have?
High buildings, so the geometry is very complex.
Yes. Yeah, so this is a statistical model. We just have a probability of line of sight, and this probability is taken from 3GPP channel model. Later, I'll confirm with measurements and simulations where we have a real city and a real measurement from the satellites from all the buildings of the city. We don't have the real geometry. We just have pixel map of heights. I would not say it's a full 3D model of a city, but a 2.5D model of the city. OK, so some other results. So this is the UAV tilt angle. So what if the UAV cannot only change the bandwidth of its antenna, the beam width of its antenna, but also tilt to track the base station? And also interesting here is we have a parameter which is the density of base stations. So we could see this as modeling a real network. So the density parameter, you could say one base station per square kilometer is macro cell, and 100 base stations per square kilometer is like micro or femtocells kind of scenario, very dense network. But you could also see this parameter as scheduling law. If you do this interference coordination and scheduling, the lambda parameter will become smaller because you schedule away the interference. So by playing with this parameter, you can choose a bit which network or how you should design your network. And what we show here is, I think maybe this parameter is, this plot is for me maybe the most easy to explain. So this is the throughput that you have in the network, and this is the base station density. If you have a ground user, then we all know that densification of the network first makes the throughput better. But at some point there will be too much interference and things will collapse. And for ground user, there's an optimal base station density where you have the maximal spectral efficiency. What you see here, if you have the UAV at 50 meter with optimal tilt angle, you could even have denser network, so that makes a lot of sense. And if you have a higher flying UAV, because the higher flying UAV, even if it tilts optimally its angle, the density will decrease. So the, what to say, high base station density is not always good for UAVs. They can overcome that to some extent by tilting the angle, but not all the time. So here you have a more, here you say to what extent I can tilt. So if I cannot tilt, and this is the throughput I have for different base station densities. And now where is the altitude? Yeah, I forgot for which altitude it is. So I think we'll have to read the paper because I cannot explain properly this figure if I don't know what the altitude of the UAV is. There's a lot of parameters to explain, but I'm strongly convinced with these kind of models because you can play really well with all these parameters, you get good insights. But then the insights are only what they are, and then we need to see, confirm this insight with reality, right? And that's why we did some simulations. So for simulations, we took a realistic 3D map, and we took the real site positions of the real base stations and built them in that city. We took the city of Ghent. We said the operator has base stations on these positions, And we tried to, we took them from our operator. We took the real antenna patterns. We tested several channel models, probabilistic and semi-deterministic channel models. And we looked at different carrier frequencies, 1.8 and 38 gigahertz, signal bandwidth, which is the LTE one, noise power, etc. So we simulate this scenario. And this is what you can see. So this is the city, and you see the buildings and the streets and the city, and you see the base station locations. And here you see an animation of the best cell as function of altitude, right? So let's look at it a little bit more. So this is simulated. At the ground inside of the buildings, we assume we have no coverage. We only do outdoor. So you see the buildings. And when you go higher, you see the cells are moving. So this is what Samira yesterday explained. This is this side lobe coverage effect. So you start being on the ground and the main lobe, and then the higher you go, you connect to side lobes, and it becomes quite unpredictable which base station is the best. But this simulation is still a simulation, but we think we take into account a lot of realistic things because it's a real city, real base station deployments, a lot of different path loss models. So what comes out?
Real measurements on the right-hand side or simulation?
This is simulations.
On the right-hand side.
Also simulation. Using this 3D city and all these path loss models, and then we go up and we see what is the best. The color at this location, the yellow base station is the best. But here, in the beginning, the yellow base station is here. And then at some point, you see that the best yellow base station is moving is the side lobe. Eh? So here is the yellow base station. And at some point, the yellow base station is not seen by nodes here, but by nodes farther away, because these nodes see its side lobe. But this is a simulation. So this is still simulation. So we have the height. And we have the mean SENR. So we see for ground users, it's like normal number that we get that we need for LTE. And if we go up, it goes down. And here is the CDF, so the SENR. At 1.5 meter, at 14 meter it's a bit higher. Now 35 is lower, and at 150 it's even lower, so we have too much interference. So the simulations confirm exactly what we had done with the stochastic geometry model. And then we were not even satisfied with the simulation, so we did also measurements. So this is a picture taken several years ago. This is a field. You need to know in Belgium, flying with UAV is extremely challenging. It's actually quite illegal, but we have opened this site where you can do amateur planes, and on that thing we could fly. So this is the field, a picture, and we have a quadrotor, and then we were flying at different altitudes, and the number of cells goes up. It confirms perfectly what we expected. So we did some more measurements. So here is from the same measurement campaign. This is the altitude, and this is the best cell. So on the ground, we see this cell. And the higher we go, we see the side lobe of the next cell. So it really confirms everything we simulated and analyzed. And then we did another measurement with a plane. So we took this USRP on the plane, and we were flying along the coast. And we were flying at 150 and at 300 meter. And also there, we confirm that we have a higher number of cells. So at 150 meter, the mean number of cells we could see was 10. And at 300, the mean number of cells we could see was 20. So we see a lot of cells. And you have to see this even at the coast. So here there are no cells. So if we would fly on mainland, it would be double. It would be 40. So it's a lot of cells you can see. And then the interference, because of that, drops. This was the mean SNR at ground level. At 150 meter it dropped, and at 300 meter it dropped. So everything confirms that there is a lot of interference. Analysis, measurement, simulation. So now that we did everything, what do I believe is the most convincing approach to analyze this? Measurement, simulations, or stochastic geometry?
Combination of
I think you always need to do everything, right? I like stochastic geometry because you can sweep the parameter. You can extrapolate what will happen with 5G, ultra dense networks, millimeter wave, very easy. In like one day of simulations. And you can understand. But you need a measurement to confirm that your models, the parameters are realistic enough. So you need everything. And then one last measurement I wanted to show for UAV uplink communication. So from the base station to the UAV, a downlink. Oh. For me, in my head, this is so difficult. For me, it's always uplink because I have, but it's downlink. So the downlink towards the sky suffers a lot from interference from the rotors and the engines itself. There's also something to take into account when building these systems. It affects a lot the reliability of your system. Okay, I don't know if how much time I maybe I should skip this. So we also did an extrapolation about toward the millimeter wave to see if we would put millimeter wave base station on all. So millimeter wave is like 30 gigahertz bandwidth. It's like the prime 5G band. Depends a bit, 26, 28, on which region in the world. But a lot of people believe that millimeter wave is never going to be possible to have full coverage with that. And we said, okay, let's imagine that we put a millimeter wave base station on exactly the same locations where we had already 1.8 gigahertz base stations and see at what altitude we get full coverage. And if millimeter wave is then better than centimeter waves at this high altitude, because maybe there is less interference. So what we have shown here, I will summarize it very quickly. Blue is LTE, red is millimeter wave. Millimeter wave is actually always worse than LTE at high altitudes. Because your line of sight has more path loss, interference also has more path loss, but you have so much more interfering cells that in the end you still have more interference. So you see here, millimeter wave is only better for some users, for the lower two, for the rooftop and the ground users. If you go above rooftop, so Leuven, Ghent is not a high city, 35 meters is above rooftop already. Millimeter wave is always worse than. And then this is the coverage as function of altitude. So at ground level, you don't have full coverage with millimeter wave, which makes sense. A lot of shadowing because of buildings. With LTE, you have full coverage because it was a network designed, an operator designed network. They have designed it for full coverage, so the simulations confirmed it. For millimeter wave, if you go to 35 meters above rooftop, you also have full coverage with the same number of sites. But you see, interference will impact you more if you go up. And then we did a study of like whether we do simple beamforming, where we don't have three sectors, but we double them. 6 until 45, which means you make very narrow sectors, or you could also see it as some kind of analog beam forming. Eh? And then it improves. Okay. So beam forming gives a high improvement for millimeter wave, because in this assumption, we assume that a sector is not used, it's off, when there's no user in that sector. Eh? And then it does not create interference. It's like a simple analog beam. So you remember the picture in the beginning where I had my phase array with 16 input ports. In this phase array, you can send 16 parallel streams. It has 16 sectors. But you could also turn off some sectors if there's no user in that angle. Eh? And then, it's also a bit statistics. Depending on the user density, you get some gain. Anyway. I didn't want to say too much more about this. I think we can go to the send and avoid. This figure is also nice. It shows first the sector, but at some point you also see the side lobes coming. Okay. Today's menu, send and avoid for drones. This was going to be the main topic of today. So I'm sorry for boring you with all these communication performance analysis. So what is send and avoid for drones? So if we think about ATM or air traffic control, and we now have manned aviation with planes. So for each mission, a flight plan is designed and delivered to the ATM entity. For instance, in Belgium, it's Belgo Control. And then they reserve the airspace for its mission and forbid other aircraft to fly in the reserve zone. To get you an idea on the separation distances, for instance, between planes, which should be at least 10 kilometers or 300 meters in altitude, is quite big, the distance. So if you think about swarms, we need big swarms. Of course, for drones, maybe we can scale it down. But the question is, how much can we scale these distances down? So we have a project. It's called Perquevite. It's French for send and avoid. And it's a CSER project. So CSER is some kind of Horizon 2020 funding club that funds projects for airspace. And it's a CSER U space project, which means it's a project. It's a cluster. There's a cluster of all kind of projects that want to think how to do this unmanned aviation traffic control kind of thing. And our assignment is to see if we could make a small payload for drones, a send and avoid payload for drones. And in our send and avoid payload for drones, we want to have maximal reliability. We want to do send and avoid using multiple technologies, vision-based, possibly 360 degree. It links to the previous project I introduced. Audio-based, because quadrotors make a lot of noise. 4G, Wi-Fi, or ADS-B-based. ADS-B is the main technology used for locationing of airplanes. Well, it's an old technology already, but even today, I think approximately only 80% of airplanes have ADS-B. So this also shows a bit how slow this field adopts new technology. So we will develop a sensor communication and processing suite for small drones. So we want to see how small can we get this package. And if why small drones? So we look at it, the vision of the project. We have different types of drones, the very expensive one, and there are not a lot of them. And the very cheap ones, for instance, Parrot drones. Parrot is also a partner in the project, so we need to focus on Parrot drones. They're less than 1,000 euro, and there are just many of them. And we need a send and avoid package that's scalable, that can work as well on the small and cheap drones, but also on the bigger drones, ideally. But for the, and the reliability matters. So for this, if you have a small drone, it will not probably kill a person, maybe some small injury, but it's not a big drama if something would still happen. For the bigger ones, yeah, of course, it's more dramatic. So we have this scalability in weight, scalability in cost, and also scalability in performance. And the goal of the project is to see how this technology should be combined in an optimal, scalable way, right? Yeah.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah, I think it's coming back.
We also have some interference here, maybe, because it's a wireless extender.
It's a wireless. Voila, but it's back. Yeah, okay. So, first, one slide, vision and audio package. What's the goal there? We want to make it cheap, so we want to make a one camera thing. It's not me, it's the colleagues from TU Delft. But even, okay, we see depth with two eyes, but even with one eye, you still see depth, no? Because you have learned to see perspective projection and also by experience.
You have to move around.
I'm sorry?
It's called active vision. I can use one eye and moving around, I can stereo.
Yeah, also, yeah. Right. But, yeah, so here they don't even do that, they just look at by learning that lanes are straight, and if you see the lines like this, it's probably some perspective thing. So they do some deep learning, and because of that, they resolve even with one camera depth, and they use that. Now, what is the problem with all these camera-based things? Before I was showing some numbers, we should see planes 10 kilometers away. How much pixels is a small drone 10 kilometers away? You don't even see it. Yeah. So vision, in my opinion, is only meaningful for small drones navigating indoor and the video I showed you before. But if you really think about the sky and there, we need RF. We need something else. So it's all about RF. So we want to make a multi-technology sense and avoid package. That's the role of my team. We want to make it very reliable. So we want to see, we have a bunch of technologies, cellular, ISM bands, sub-gigahertz ISM bands, and also ADS-B for communicating with planes. So how can we integrate this in a very lightweight package, and how can we make reliable send and avoid with that? So the objectives, what we want to make our package that works, that makes send and avoid, we have two situations. We have what we call collaborative drones. So what are collaborative drones? Collaborative drones is a drone that also has our send and avoid package. And because if both of them have the package, we can exchange messages, but we should do that fast. We also have non-collaborative drones that don't have the package. Maybe they send some RF packets and we can overhear that something is being sent. Maybe you can do some angle of arrival to see there's some RF transmission happening in that angle, but more than that we cannot do. Maybe you can sniff and overhear, but we cannot go into a meaningful exchange. So this, and then of course this will be more costly, so this adds to the trade-off curve. Okay. So this was an interactive session. Assignment. We have two drones, and they're placed on x-axis and they're moving towards each other with a velocity of 30 kilometers per hour. What's the ratio of the safety zone when using connected Wi-Fi? Connected Wi-Fi, you need about 1 minute to set up a connection. So how far should they be apart? When, at what distance should they overhear each other? Should they start setting up the connection so that they can send a Wi-Fi package? Because they need to send their trajectory and they need to be able to maneuver away.
More than 500 meters.
Quite far. More than a kilometer. Because it's like 30 kilometers per hour. So 1 minute is, so you can compute it. So it's quite far. Actually, on the border of the Wi-Fi range, I would say. So can it work? Connected Wi-Fi? At what? The distance.
If they have to like connect when they are already so far apart, but then they cannot.
So it cannot. So we need we cannot rely on connected Wi-Fi. So we need to do something else. So assignment two. What happens? So LTE. I don't know how familiar you were with LTE or cellular and 5G, but they claim low latency. Yeah? So this is this is an Ericsson 5G roadmap slide. I took it quickly. So this is like scheduling requests, depending on how. So an LTE frame structure is 10 milliseconds. So if you have up and down link, always you need 20 milliseconds at least for the radio access already. And depending on the scheduling request, the probability that you get this ideal 20 milliseconds is higher. Huh? So but anyway, 20 milliseconds is the best you can do for LTE access network. But if you want to go also through some core network and to the other access network, it's going to be milliseconds. So, but it's still better than the minutes. And for 5G, they claim that they can do a lot better. And this, of course, all assumes that.
It depends on topology heavily.
On topology, yes.
Yeah.
And you're connected already.
I mean, it depends where you close the loop. If you're going to go all the way up, it's actually much higher than that.
So measurement, LTE measurement are typically 200 milliseconds, I would say, around trip time. It's still a lot better than the Wi-Fi case, but what is different than the Wi-Fi example I gave you, here you're connected already. Yeah? You are connected. The Wi-Fi was, I'm not connected, I'm just flying.
Why do you need to be connected?
For Wi-Fi, you don't need to be.
For this exercise, we can do it without connection, without just visiting.
Yeah, so this is what
we can show them whenever, I mean, I can show you the experiment, they come very close and they go like this. The only thing you need to know is that you have a strategy that we all go to the right, because if he goes to the right,
Yeah, you need some rules. But these rules exist. So these rules exist. Yeah. So the only thing indeed, we need something that's not connected. And then we were thinking, okay, what would be good? And okay, I forgot my slide structure. So we said, okay, why don't we just put the GPS location in the SSID, which is something that you broadcast anyway, everybody over here. So if you now open up your laptop, how long does it take before you see the SSID list popping up of all the Wi-Fis? Sometimes it also takes a while. Eh?
Yes.
Yeah, and why does that take a while? Because I have many channels. Yeah, I need to scan, and depending on which channel I'm scanning and where the Wi-Fi is. But anyway, so we did a lot of work there. I'm not, maybe not going to go into all the details on how, on which channel we should transmit, on which channel we should receive. And my student, he measured a lot of chipsets to see if the receiver moves channel, how much percent of the time is it really listening, or how much percent of the time is the local oscillator tuning to the new channel, and there's some red, I'm not hearing anything. So based on that, he did some analysis of different strategies. So what are the different strategies? Strategy A is, I fix a channel. I say, okay, SSID, GPS broadcast for drone is always going to be on channel 2. Transmitter and receiver know that, and they always listen to channel 2. It's good because I can always overhear the SSIDs. I don't have channel changing overhead, but it's unreliable. Eh? I can jam it right away. The second strategy is my transmitter is hopping, and my receiver is always on the same channel. Or my receiver is not always on the same channel. It randomly picks a channel that it did that for him at this location is kind of interference or jammer free. So this means that the receiver, once it has decided on a good channel, can stay there. All these red things of moving channel can be removed. But the transmitter still has to sweep all the channels because it does not know every UAV can have decided a different channel. It's more reliable, but I have less switching time. The other strategy is the transmitter is always on one channel and the receiver. The transmitter is always on a channel that is good and the receiver scans. Or the alternative is everybody scans randomly. Okay, yeah, sorry. So yeah, so it turns out that strategy B is the best. The transmitter sweeps, the receiver stays because receive switching is more difficult than transmit switching. And then we did some measurements. We implemented this on very cheap Wi-Fi hardware, the cheapest and lightest we could find, 5 gram, very bad processor. But we said if we can make it work here, then it can work on all the drones in the world, even the cheap ones from China. And this is the probability to get a GPS SSID within 2 seconds. These are the numbers you're quite reliable, measurement based. Okay. So the next step of this is to go to LTE, which is a more expensive but more reliable. Latencies are better if you're connected. We also want to go to sub-gigahertz. Why sub-gigahertz? LoRa, Sigfox kind of thing, because of the range. It goes a lot farther, so you can go to even faster drones. We also will integrate ADS-B using RTL-SDR for planes. ADS-B is a every airplane sends once every second an ADS-B message, which is its location, right? And we also will integrate angle of arrival to for the non-collaborative. Yeah. Okay. What to still expect? So I had to go a bit fast, but that's not a problem because we'll organize a big symposium where we'll explain all this in Delft. Descend and avoid with the CSAR Club. The CSAR Club are all the projects working on this unmanned airspace management. I think it's interesting to engage with that community because they make the laws, right? It's a bit, it's if you want to work on swarms of drones and we have to think on how this will ever become possible, you should do this, you should engage with that community. So today's menu, I'm done with the menu, but of course I have to also add a little bit of conclusions if I still have 1 minute. So towards safe and reliable drones and swarms, it's important to have both, I strongly believe, local autonomy and a reliable link. I see no reason why you would only have one or the other. You need both. And also we need cooperative and non-cooperative sense and avoid. Cooperative, if everybody has the same package, but non-cooperative, even to avoid people. People will not wear a sense and avoid package for drones. Or maybe in the future it will be necessary, I don't know, that everybody has a sense and avoid thing to say to drones, look, avoid me. I'm not sure if you will ever have a license-free airspace where drone can autonomously navigate in full 3D to freely optimize their mission parameters. I think some organization might be needed. CSAR is thinking about corridors, like streets, but corridors. I think we should engage with them to make sure these corridors are still allowing innovation. And even today, beyond visual line of sight control is not even allowed. Today. Not even autonomous, without even even beyond visible line of sight with a reliable link today is not even allowed. So we still have a long way to go toward this autonomous swarm's vision. Okay, and then, sorry. But okay, of course, okay, my microphone already gave up too. So what I want to work on, further on sense and avoid for very dense swarms where we will need to cluster, have leadership, multi-technology for intra and inter-swarm sense and avoid, and also possibly how to interact better with humans without having humans to wear also a sense and avoid watch or something like that. I also want to work more on cell-free networks. I have a small video there, if it's still allowed. Yeah, the Wi-Fi is a bit bad. But in my lab, I have a very nice visible light communication cell-free network, a lot of LEDs on the wall. And the LEDs are robots because they can turn their field of view. If the video comes, you will see it. And it's kind of, I see this as many robots that follow somebody on the ground. And yesterday we have this talk about the superlinear scaling of swarms. I strongly believe if we have this, if we have these drones, these robots, voilà, it will probably not work. Eh? Where is my pointer even? Yeah. Yeah, I will not even try. I see them as, so we have 36 LEDs on the wall and they have engines, they can rotate towards the user on the floor. We have 36 transmitters, less than 36 receivers. So we have a swarm of transmitters helping one receiver, so we can have this superlinear improvement, right? I think I'm pretty sure from massive MIMO and cell-free communication theory, we can prove that we can have this cooperation benefit there. And I see some. So the swarm of transmitters are not very visible now. But here you see them, eh? So they're little robots that follow the receiver. So this is kind of. Yeah, okay. In sake of time, I will stop it here. But I hope you're convinced that we have robot transmitters, eh? And then the last thing I wanted to. The really, really last thing. Yeah, okay. Is green communication. So yesterday we saw this nice presentation where we had somebody growing plants. Of course, trees have been used already more than 100 years as antennas. They're working antennas. And I think it would be really fantastic to have really green, recyclable communication with real antenna trees and see how we can grow them optimally to optimize some kind of performance. So these are a bit all the ideas I had so far. Of course, we can discuss more during the coffee break or during the social event if people have better ideas, of course. Sorry for that.